In the interest of time, I'm inclined to just let you begin.
Okay.
I mean, I can give you the same speech I give a lot of other people, but you probably know most of it anyway, so.
Very good.
And besides, I'm going to be speaking at the chamber in a couple weeks, and I should probably save some of it for that, since I'm sure somebody will be there from the paper.
Yes, we will definitely be there. Jess had a question out of Weymouth, which is why she is here.
Right, so I'm sure the compressor station is something you get a lot of questions about. It's kind of expanded now. I know Quincy's on board with funding for a lawyer to come in and kind of oppose the FERC decision. Hingham now is paying a little bit more attention to it. At first, I was wondering if you've ever visited the site, the compressor station.
I've seen the site.
You've seen it?
I mean, there's a compressor there now. I haven't visited lately.
And, you know, I know you've said before, it's a lot of it goes to the federal government for decision. There's a few state permits or federal laws that the state implements.
The state oversees federal law on behalf of the feds for a variety of things, but it's federal law.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the other stuff is stuff that the FERC can preempt if they choose to.
Right. So,
And if there were ever a disagreement or a dispute, it would be settled in federal court.
Right, right. So, do you have an opinion on the compressor station?
There's a compressor station there now. The decision that was made to upgrade the compressor is one that was made by the private entity that currently operates it. The decision about the future of the compressor station is going to be made by FERC, and I understand people's concerns about the question that's before the feds, but in the end, it's a decision that will be made by FERC and by the federal government, and as I've said a number of times, I would hope people engage their federal representatives and the federal administration on this, because they are the decision makers.
And when you say,
I mean, people, there are a lot of issues that involve federal decision making where I'm not the decider, and that's true in transportation, it's true in healthcare, it's true in education, it's true in a number of areas, and this is one of them.
But you're definitely an influencer.
No, I'm not. That's the point. I'm not an influencer. This is going to be decided by FERC.
And you don't think that it's your role to attempt to be an influencer?
On an issue like this, they're going to make a decision about whether or not they believe this is an infrastructure call around national security that they're ultimately going to make. And they're going to decide whether or not they believe that for national security purposes, we have enough infrastructure in the northeastern part of the country to provide what they consider to be critical services to the region. And that's not a decision, and that decision is going to be based on federal law and federal judgment and the decision of FERC. And I encourage everybody to take it up with the feds.
I guess to be devil's advocate a little bit, I mean, healthcare, for example, like you said. You know, as a governor, you've still taken a hard stance on matters, you know, about the Affordable Care Act and any replacement law.
And I've had a lot of people say I've gone nowhere near far enough in my advocacy on the Affordable Care Act, too.
Mm-hmm.
I got asked by Congressman McCarthy to submit comments to him based on, he asked all 50 governors to submit comments. Some took him seriously on it, some didn't. I wrote a long letter.
Mm-hmm.
Based on our experience with regard to this, based on federal law and our perspective on how the Affordable Care Act has worked here in the Commonwealth serving the people of Massachusetts. And we continue to engage with them because it's an administrative process.
Mm-hmm.
It's totally different than the process that FERC employs and the issue that's at stake on the FERC decision. And but in the end, the feds are going to make the decisions they think are the most appropriate there. Same goes with education policy.
On the Health Care Act, Governor, are you in touch this week with this train again, supposedly moving, maybe by Friday they'll have a vote on, we don't know what as yet, but I mean, there are significant changes that could come out of that if indeed they could reach some sort of compromise. Are you in touch with Washington on that?
Well, I mean, the good news on all this is that House has to pass something, Senate has to pass something, House and Senate have to agree on what they each pass, goes to the President. There's a lot of process involved here. I think the current version, to the extent I understand it, and there's a lot of details that are not all that obvious, it would cost the Commonwealth north of $1 billion and would put all the work that's been done over the past decade here in Massachusetts at great risk. And I would hope that the feds don't move on that bill, as I understand it currently, and we've communicated that to our congressional delegation, who ultimately, if it does come to the floor, will have a chance to vote on it. We've had conversations with other governors who are in a similar place to ours, some of whom have Republican members of the House and the Senate and their delegations, and we've urged them to engage in similar kinds of conversations with their reps and senators under the notion that because they have people who sit on the majority side, that can make a difference. But it's not good for Massachusetts, if that's the question you're asking. And but again, they're gonna, you know, they may or may not take a vote by the end of this week. We'll see.
You don't think that the idea of giving states more power is being discussed? Would thus being shafted as opposed to being able, you wouldn't have the federal money. Is that the bottom line?
I think if you talk to most governors, they would probably tell you. I think if you talk to a lot of members of Congress too, they would probably tell you privately that there are issues with the way the Affordable Care Act is structured that are legitimate and ought to be dealt with. I mean, we made that very clear in the letter we wrote to Representative McCarthy, that there were a lot of things about the Affordable Care Act that we thought should be changed. But the formula, as we understand it, and again, it's hard to tell, okay? But the formula, as we understand it, would probably cost the Commonwealth at least $1 billion a year by 2020, and probably a lot more than $1 billion in the out years. And do I believe that some of the flexibility that might come out of the proposal would be worth the consequences of the change in the financial relationship between the Commonwealth and the federal government? The answer to that is no. And I think in some respects, that's the message we tried to communicate to the delegation and to others.
Would a new law, would that impact the state's current healthcare law?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
It would.
I mean, and again, there aren't as many details as we would like on this. We're working to some extent off of the CBO analysis that was done on the previous bill and sort of making some assumptions about how you would adjust that CBO analysis under the new proposal, as we understand it. But there would be, there would be a significant financial consequence to the Commonwealth and to our existing program. We would have to fill a hole with state or local funds that would probably be north of $1 billion a year, mm-hmm. which is, enormous.
And it also
would change the, I mean, part of what troubles me about this is we spent 2 years as an administration negotiating a new 5-year waiver with the federal government, which we put literally tens of thousands of person hours into. And we signed it in good faith with Washington, with the previous administration. And it had all kinds of assumptions about what we were supposed to do and all kinds of commitments that they were supposed to make. And our big concern about the current bill that's before Congress is that a lot of what was in that waiver would be lost and very hard to retrieve if it were to pass.
Governor, if I could ask.
But again, there's still the, you know, they got to get it through the House, they got to get
right.
something through the Senate. I mean, several members of the Senate have already said they won't support it on the Republican
right.
side, so.
What else coming out of the current administration concerns you as the governor of a state right now?
Well, some of the, I mean, obviously some of the rhetoric and some of the activity around the executive orders on immigration are concerning. And there's a bunch of reasons for that. I mean, we have a lot of colleges and universities that have a lot of international students. They have a lot of international fellows. They have a lot of visiting professors. I mean, there's a huge element of sort of intellectual capital that exists all over the world that likes to come to Massachusetts either for a short stay or a long stay. And a lot of people who are going to medical school or making fellowship decisions or graduate school decisions have been making those decisions in the midst of this uncertainty about the rules of the game. And that's had some impact. If you talk to any of the colleges and universities that have big international footprints, they'll tell you that's had some impact on people's decisions about where to go. And that they fear that the uncertainty and the concerns about travel have negatively impacted acceptance rates with respect to all kinds of elements associated with that. You also have global employers who get nervous about, let's suppose you have operations all over the world, and those operations often employ people who are who live in those countries, right? Let's suppose you want to have a conference in Massachusetts. It might be difficult to get some of those people into the country. It might be difficult to get them to come here to work on a project. I mean, there's lots of, we've done a really, in my opinion, we've done a really good job as a Commonwealth of becoming part of the global community, economically, educationally, healthcare, technologically, and if you take a look at all that stuff and you talk to a lot of the folks who play in those international spaces, they'll tell you that the uncertainty that's been created by a lot of the federal dialogue on this stuff, even with some of the court decisions, has given people cause for pause. And if they have other options, some people are pursuing them. I mean, we worked really hard over the course of the past 10 or 15 years to expand Logan Airport's capacity to do nonstops all over the world. And it's part of the reason why GE decided to locate their headquarters here. It's part of the reason why a number of other global companies have put big footprints in Massachusetts, because we now have an airport that serves 50 or 60 foreign destinations on direct flights. We lose some of the benefit associated with the work that people did to make Massachusetts part of the global community when stuff like this happens. And we've had, you know, I actually wrote a long letter to John Kelly, who's the Homeland Security Secretary, about this issue, because I'd heard from so many colleges and universities and employers about their concerns about this.
I mean, did you hear back from him?
I talked to him a little bit about it, the answer, I would describe it as an ongoing conversation.
Are there other sorts of things you're doing?
Well, I spent a bunch of time talking to Secretary Chao about the Green Line extension, which has been on the boards since the Big Dig. That pathway into Somerville is one of the most heavily densely populated parts on the Eastern Seaboard, and part of the reason why the feds were willing in the first place to invest there is probably because Congressman Capuano put a lot of work into it, but part of it was also because the case could be made that this would be a heavily trafficked expansion if it were to be developed. And there's $1 billion. I don't know if you guys want to hear the whole history of this, but the way this project was really conceived, it was $1 billion from the feds and $1 billion from the state to build this spur into Somerville. And the when we took office, we did an analysis of a bunch of the big projects at the T, and one of them was this, and we concluded it was actually a $3 billion project, not a $2 billion project, so we stopped it and did a ton of value engineering on it to get it down to about $2.3 billion, and then talked to Somerville and Cambridge and the other metros, and they agreed to put $300 million in, our billion, the Fed's billion, would fund the project after we value engineered it. And then we sent it back to the Federal Transportation Administration for them to do a review of our new proposed plan, which we felt worked within the parameters of what they were willing to do, what we had agreed to pay, and all the rest. And so I've had several conversations with the folks at Transportation about that. I know our team has too at the staff level, and we got positive news from DOT about this. I'm going to say 4 or 5 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Maybe less. 3 weeks ago? 2 or 3 weeks ago? So we now are submitting kind of what I would describe as the final plan on our end to live up to our commitments. And hopefully that project will move forward because it's a good project as it's currently conceived. But, you know, generally speaking, most of the conversations that take place between state government and federal government usually happen at what I would call kind of the operating level. The secretary of this, the secretary of that, the administrator of this, the administrator of that. That's usually where most of the dialogue is, unless you have direct contact to the White House, which I don't have.
Speaking of Congressman Capuano, he was at a panel discussion yesterday and talked about your role in insulating the state from a lot of the budgetary cuts now being discussed in D.C. And obviously we talked about healthcare, but also there's things like community block grants, NIH funding, that kind of thing. Do you see yourself playing a role as a moderate Republican governor in protecting the state from what happens in D.C.?
Well, we're always going to do whatever we can to protect the state's finances. The NIH one's a good example. I mean, the original proposal that was made by the Trump administration was to cut the NIH by about $6 billion. And that raised a lot of bipartisan concern in Washington, Democrats and Republicans, who came out and said, that's a problem. And on that one, we had conversations with, we are an enormous player in the inquiry and discovery that's financed by NIH, okay, period. We just are. It's a big issue for us economically, but it's also a big issue for the country, and I would argue for the world scientifically, because we do a tremendous amount of really, there's a reason why we are, there's a reason why we receive a lot of money from the NIH. It's because a lot of the best talent in the world on a whole bunch of issues is here to begin with. But there are a number of other states that play big in the NIH, and we talked to a bunch of them and encouraged them to talk to their delegations, and we certainly talked to ours. But I think most of the time the process, unless there's something I can, the NIH is an example of where the game or the debate, the discussion was going to take place in Congress. So from my point of view, I knew where the Massachusetts delegation would be, obviously. But our goal was to talk to our colleagues in other states that had big rates of participation in NIH generally, and encourage them to talk to their congressional delegation, their U.S. senators. And we also talked to a lot of the colleges and universities around here and the academic medical centers, and just tried to do what we could to make sure we were all coordinated on our messaging and who we were talking to. One of the interesting things about some of our colleges and universities is their reach is pretty deep. Between their alumni networks and the folks they work with and folks who've benefited from a lot of the research and a lot of the work they've done, they have friends and fans and allies all over the country. And in a conversation like this, they weren't afraid to use them. And I think the good news is the proposal that came out in the continuing resolution was actually a $2 billion increase in NIH funding as opposed to a $6 billion cut. So that's a good sign.
But as a Republican, do you see a role for you in working with your colleagues in other state houses and communicating to the White House what these kind of cuts mean for you at the state level, at the budgetary level?
Sure. But the thing to remember here is that we have, I'm one voice, okay? It's much more effective, I believe anyway, it's more effective for me to be one of several voices, and to the extent that I can engage other governors who have similar circumstances, like around the healthcare stuff. There are a lot of 1115 waivers out there, probably, there's more than 30. Right? And since there's 33 Republican governors, that means there's a bunch of governors who have 1115 waivers out there. There are a bunch of governors who took the Medicaid expansion. Some were taken by a Democrat before they got elected, but some of them took it themselves. And those coalitions are really where I think my opportunity to be effective on stuff that's before Congress is. On the stuff that's direct with the administration, I guess I would say it depends on the issue. I spent a lot of time talking to Elaine Chao about the GLX project because it was a work in progress and something that I felt that was a good project and was consistent with the administration's desire to spend more on infrastructure. And, so far, that's turned out to be helpful. We've had some conversations with them about our waiver, which obviously is important to us. And on that one, the administration's stated position has been to try to give states flexibility where they can. And we'll, pursue those discussions wherever they take us. But I think on most of the congressional stuff, our best opportunity is to communicate effectively with our delegation, but then to go find other governors who have similar situations and circumstances that we have on particular issues to see if we can build coalitions that way. And also to leverage some of the people we have here that have big national footprints. I mean, we shouldn't underestimate the pull and the significance of a lot of our educational and scientific and medical and healthcare institutions. They have a lot of fans all over the place, and those fans are willing to speak up on their behalf.
Do you want to talk briefly about your change to the wiretapping law that you're
going to
announce a little later today?
So, our wiretap law is very old. Right. I was 12. And it's very narrow. I mean, it's basically designed to be used only in circumstances that involve what I would call sort of organized crime type activity. Now, the problem with that is the world's changed, times change, things change, and we've been unable, as a commonwealth, to secure judicial support for wiretaps in situations that involve all sorts of other activities. Serious crimes, murder, rape, terrorism, stuff like that, where given the nature of the law as it's currently written, a judge would not have the discretion or the flexibility to grant a wiretap if all, local law enforcement had exhausted all other ways of collecting data and took their case to a judge and said, this is why we believe we need the wiretap. Under our current law, judges more often than not end up saying, we can't give you a wiretap, even though we think that would probably make sense from a public safety and the SJC has actually written in several different decisions that they would like, that they wish our law had given judges more latitude with respect to when they could issue permission around a wiretap. And I think we believe this will not just update the law, but also bring it into what I would call consistency with what you see in most other states. In the end, the goal here is to respect the important role that judges play in making decisions on this, but to give them a little more latitude to make decisions based on the facts on the ground than they have today. And as I said, we've had decisions written by the SJC where they've said we wish the decision could have been different, but under existing state law, it can't be. And the DA supported, the victims, victim advocates supported. I think there's going to be a fair amount of support for this.
I mean, you said that this covers, you know, the most serious crimes, but it also covers some things like drug distribution and witness intimidation, which can, you know, be something.
I consider those to be pretty serious too. Yeah,
they can be, but it can also be, it can be less serious. I mean,
well,
like something like grabbing somebody's cell phone.
Facts on the ground. Judges make the call, right? Yeah. I mean, you're still talking about a situation where you're going to have to go before a magistrate and have a magistrate review the facts on facts of the case and make a decision about whether or not to grant it, which nobody's proposing to change that. We think that's, you know, fundamental to the way this process should work. We appreciate, by the way, the support the Attorney General's given us on this, the DAs have given us on this. I mean, there's a lot of interest in seeing if we can't get this done. We filed legislation last week to update our explicit images law as well, which is also old. And, you know, under current Massachusetts state law, if somebody consensually agrees to take explicit pictures with you, we don't have, under current law, the ability to stop that person from distributing those online, on the internet, wherever they want. And before there was an internet and before pictures were digital, I could sort of understand that. But in this day and age, it seems crazy not to be able to charge somebody if they are in fact engaging in what people call revenge porn. But in addition to that, under our current law on explicit images, if two teenagers send images back and forth, you either have to hammer somebody with a pretty serious sexual child porn charge or do nothing. And again, we think that's outdated at this point in time, and the law ought to be more like presume that what really ought to happen here is education about some of the dangers associated with this sort of behavior for kids, and to give DAs some capacity to send kids that way rather than the way it sits now, which is either a hammer or nothing. So, I mean, some of this is about just trying to bring. We're not screwing around with a lot of the processing, and the facts on the ground will determine most of the time what happens. But we do think in a number of these cases, people need more latitude than they have to protect public safety.
Well, and you talked about bringing the wiretapping law in line with what most other states do. And of course, I made a joke earlier, but the provision that has to do with wiretapping among civilians is also out of line with what most other states do. I think there's 11 states now that have the two-party consent rule. And I know there's certainly some groups have called for addressing that. I don't, probably not the, what you hear from the DAs, but was there any talk about updating that too to be in line with what most states do?
Well, we haven't, I mean, truthfully, I've had a lot of people raise this wiretap issue with me. I haven't had a lot of people complain about our outlier status on the other one.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm, you know, we talk to people about this stuff all the time. I'm happy to raise it with them and see what they say.
So that it just didn't come up in the discussion about...
It really didn't. I mean, not in this discussion anyway.
Yeah. I'm good.
Okay. recently, we did a story about Massachusetts trial court's capital budget plan, including a proposal for a new courthouse in downtown Quincy and moving Norfolk Superior Court from Dedham to Quincy. Some city officials off the record were saying that they thought it was a little pie in the sky. Do you have any thoughts on it?
You know, we've been working our way through a 5-year capital plan. It will probably be publicly available sometime before the end of June. It'll probably be before the end of June, mm-hmm. but I don't know if it will be. I don't know exactly when it's going to be done because there's a lot of moving pieces to it. I can't speak to the specifics of that one, mostly because that's been an ongoing conversation between the ANF folks and the courts over sort of what their primary interests are. And I will say this, generally speaking, we have a lot of maintenance and modernization work we need to do with all of our public buildings. We've not been good about what I would call just deferred maintenance. We have a ton of deferred maintenance, and I think we're going to look to fix a lot of stuff that hasn't been fixed for a really long time, and it won't be sexy, and it won't be there won't be a lot of ribbon cutting in this, but we've let a lot of our public assets go, and we need to spend some money to both maintain and modernize them.
Just wondering what your thoughts are with regard to the opiate crisis, the latest kind of twist on this, these injection, clinics?
I haven't seen the proposal yet. It was just mm-hmm. announced. As somebody who came out of the healthcare world, I've said before, and I'm a big fan of the people in the healthcare world, I do believe the healthcare community played a major role in creating this epidemic. And I'm glad to see them engaging in thoughts and ideas about what to do about it. I appreciate the fact that, at least on the prevention and education piece, we've made some significant progress around educating prescribers, both those who are currently in school, medical school, dental school, nursing school, pharmacy school. We're the only state in the country where you can't graduate from any of those places without taking and passing a course in opioid therapy and pain management, and also making it a requirement for people to get relicensed that they take and pass a course in opioid therapy and pain management. It's amazing to me that a very small portion of the prescriber community ever took a course or got educated in this stuff, even as we were writing 240 million prescriptions a year in the United States. So on some level, I'm glad that they're thinking about this and trying to come up with ways to deal with it. The big question in my mind is, does this help people get better? And I would like to talk to them about that and get some sense on that question. Goal number one, let's help people keep from getting addicted in the first place, because getting off of opioid addiction is incredibly hard, okay? I mean, there's nothing like it, I don't think. I mean, I'm sure everybody who's dealing with addiction would say every form of addiction is brutal, but this one seems to me to be particularly brutal. So the more we can do to keep people from becoming addicted in the first place, I think in the long run, the better off we're gonna be. We significantly increased funding for treatment. It's up by 50% on the state side since we've taken office, and we also implemented the 14-day stay on the private side. There's also big elements in our waiver that are attached to enhancing and expanding both behavioral health services and addiction services for people around MassHealth, which we believe is going to continue to be part of this thing going forward, which is really important to us. But my big question, and I'm happy to consider unorthodox approaches. I mean, when I first got asked about what they were doing up in Gloucester, what I think about that, I said, we should try stuff and see what works. This one, I just need to know more about, because I need to understand the path to success on this one. And I also want to know how much more the medical community is willing to deal with the prevention and education piece. Because you can't create an epidemic like this one without a big distribution channel, and the big distribution channel here has been the healthcare community. I mean, when I first started hearing about this stuff everywhere I went as a candidate, I went to visit some of my friends who work in a hospital ER, and I said, not for nothing, but I'm hearing about this opioid epidemic practically everywhere I'm going. Is this for real? And they said, yeah, it's an avalanche. And they were telling me stories about what they dealt with every night and all the rest. And I said, guys, you've known me for a long time. And you knew I was running for governor. How come none of you ever reached out and called me? They said, well, we're just, you know, just trying to manage what's coming through the door. So I then went and talked to some people on the inpatient side who said to me that, you know, 2/3 of the people who get admitted to a hospital end up with an opioid prescription. 15% of those are still on it a year later, and 8% of them have a problem. Now, 15% of 65%, 8% of 15% of 65% is not a huge number when you think about it, but if that's like every day, okay, it becomes a really big number over the course of a long period of time. And while we've made some progress with prescribing, I mean, I think it's down about 15% since we put in the 7-day first prescription limit and the and upgraded and dramatically improved the quality of the prescription monitoring program. We're still writing 4 million scripts a year in Massachusetts. And I still hear all the time from people about, you know, minor procedure, 30 Percocet, minor procedure, 40 Vicodin, minor procedure, 30 OxyContin. I mean,
did you say dentists were included in that? Yeah.
No, I mean, so I want to hear a lot about, look, I hate the fact that so many people are losing their lives over this, and I hate what this is doing to families and communities everywhere. And if this idea of the medical societies, which they seem to think will make a difference, I'm happy to talk to them. But I also want to talk some more about what we're going to do about the front end of this, okay? Because it didn't happen overnight, and it didn't happen by accident. And if we don't deal with what's going on the front end, I worry a lot that we won't be able to solve it just by thinking about it, what we can do on the back end.
Are you concerned that you're not hearing enough from the White House on, you know, in passing it'll come up every now and then, they'll mention opiates, but it doesn't seem to be treated as a problem.
Keep in mind, we just got $12 million from the feds through the Cures Act, which we wrote letters of support for opioid treatment and addiction treatment here in Massachusetts. And the president did create this council, which Chris Christie is chairing, governor of New Jersey, and I serve on along with Governor Cooper, who's a Democrat from North Carolina. There are three governors and then some public health and addiction people. But we've probably talked to somewhere between 30 and 40 governors and their staffs about what people are doing in different states to deal with this issue. And we expect and anticipate that we'll be able to incorporate some of these ideas into a national platform. And there have been people from the White House on every one of these calls. We've probably done 5 or 6 hours worth of calls over the course of the past 3 or 4 weeks on this stuff. And they seem pretty serious about it. I mean, Chris Christie's very serious about this. New Jersey's done a lot of really interesting work in this space. And if you've never watched he got asked about addiction at one of his town meetings up in New Hampshire, and I think he gave one of the best answers I've ever heard in my life on why this issue matters and why it's important that we go after it. And the president himself, you know, lost his brother to addiction, it was alcohol addiction. But I think people are pretty serious about wanting to do something here.
Are there any safeguards in place or monitoring in place? We have discussed within the newsroom, and it's something that we're eventually going to be taking a closer look at. When you have so much attention focused on a problem and the general consensus seems to be that one of the ways to address this is you need more treatment, and federal money begins to come in, state money begins to come in for treatment programs. It suddenly takes on the appearance of there's potential here for this to become big business. And we're starting to see some private companies coming in. We're wondering about, nobody I think is really certain what works in terms of treatment. This might work for this person, that might work for that. Is there any monitoring going on to make sure that people don't take advantage of what has become a I don't want to say popular issue, but...
Didn't somebody get arrested down here just recently? Wasn't it... I think it was on the South Shore.
It was a Suboxone provider. Yes. Yeah, that was...
That was down here somewhere.
It was Weymouth.
Weymouth. It was in Weymouth? Okay.
Yeah, it was a couple of years ago. But
They're...
We'll look.
I'm not that old. I think you should
look it up.
Check. But your question is a good one, okay? And we've done, I think we're trying to do a bunch of the right things on this, because I worry a lot about this. Mm-hmm. In fact, I'd love to tell you what I think about this, if you're willing to let me tell you off the record.
Sure.